Amen. The brothers have led us so successfully to our worship service thus far. And folks, I'm feeling really good right now. Really, really happy. You know, the other night we had three baptisms. Three. Now, one is great, but can you imagine three? And they were all related. An absolute beautiful thing. So normally what happens when I feel this good, I tend to speak real fast. So if I get to going, I'm going too fast, just let one of the brothers know and they'll give me a heads up to slow down. But I'm gonna be focused on making it clear. I try to make my lessons clear. Hopefully this one will be as clear. I've decided to title this lesson as I thought about, we've had quite a few baptisms, so we have a lot of new Christians in. So I want to give them something that they can keep and use every day of their lives. It's called the Spiritual Bulletproof Vest. The Spiritual Bulletproof Vest. Now, years ago, I had a friend that was very godly, Bob Vernon, the deputy chief of LAPD. And he loved talking about training. And I remember him talking, he said, it was the second day on the job. And they went through training about putting on the vest and everything that they're supposed to do every day. And he said the second day on the job, they picked him to ride in what they called the interceptor. That was the kind of police car where if there was a high-speed chase, they called them to get out there. The car was souped up, had highly mechanized engine. So when he was sitting there, him and his partner was having lunch, and the call came. And the car that was the bad guy was coming right past them. As they passed him, he said the adrenaline the rush was unbelievable. They turned on the siren and got in behind him. They got in behind the car. They were able to pull up beside him, made him pull over. When they got out, a shootout ensued. He said they ended up emptying both rounds of their pistols. And both of the bad guys eventually raised their hands. They gave up. He cuffed them, but he wondered why his partner hadn't made it around the car. He looked back around to the car and his partner was on the ground. And he walked over and he saw where his partner had been hit, but he said he's got his vest on. Opened up his vest and he saw, opened up his uniform and it was blood. He didn't put his vest on that morning. Said they put their vest on every day. And as his partner was coughing and gagging, he didn't make it. He said, this is the wrong day. I should have put my vest on. I thought it was going to be too hot. So can you imagine? He could have been a little bit uncomfortable, but lived. But because he didn't put on what he was trained to do, it cost him his life. And make no mistake, when you wear a bulletproof vest, you still feel the impact. You may even go down, but you're able to get back up and fight another day. God has given us a spiritual bulletproof vest. You can read about it in detail in Ephesians 6. I want to deal with the mentality first. Because see, if he would have had the right mentality, he would have said, well, no, we're riding interceptor. There's a high percentage chance we'll get into a fight with some bad guys. Let me put it on. If Bob Vernon, my buddy, had that mentality, he wears it every day faithfully to this very day. Let's see what God has for us with our spiritual bulletproof vest. It comes from a verse that you all hear me talk about a lot. I hit it at least every other Bible study because it's one of those verses you can apply to every situation you're going through. No matter how easy it may seem or how bad it may seem, you can use this verse. And I'd encourage all of us to devote it to memory, especially if you're new in the faith. The outline, so you know who I am throughout. I tend not to preach too long, but I like to give an outline so you know where I am. First part we're going to deal with is called the perspective, or the way you should look at going through life as a Christian. The second part is called the power, or we need to always tie back into the source that we were birthed from. Third part is the providence, knowing that God has got this set up. No matter how bad it may seem, God has got this set up. The next to the last part is the plan. God has a plan for us, even beyond salvation. And the last part is the pathway. You know, it's good to set goals and everything, but you must be ready when God redirects you somewhere else. Are you open enough to follow what the Bible says, no matter what you have been taught previously? because it all boils down to the word. Let's get into this. Let's deal with the perspective first. 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Now we're going to focus with the perspective. We're just focusing on, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. Now that's powerful. That's saying no matter what you're going through, somebody else has been through it. How many times have you heard people say, especially when they're down and out, you don't know what I'm going through. And almost every time I'll say, you're right, but I know who does know what you're going through. That's why I'm taking you to the Bible. Don't isolate. Satan wants you to isolate yourself and feel like nobody can understand what I'm going through. That's a miscalculation. That's tying more into what Satan would have you to do than what God would have you to do. But notice it mentions that word temptation. And that's something we need, a word we need to deal with, because many times we jump to the sin. But before a sin is committed, there's some form of temptation. And what's dangerous about temptation, we all aren't tempted by the same stuff. I've had buddies when I came out of the Marine Corps that wanted to give up drinking, they couldn't drive past a state liquor store. But even being near alcohol was too tempting. Just for some reason, alcohol has never tempted me. You could take every piece of alcohol out of the world. It wouldn't bother me one bit. It just, that doesn't tempt me. Other things do, but not that. So we have to know and be honest with ourselves and with God what tempts us. Now, what do we know about this temptation? Let's look at 1 John 2 and 16. It's going to tell us all where all temptation comes from. It says, for all that is in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Now, how do we learn how to deal with this? What should be our perspective? We're going to see the master teacher, Jesus himself, when he's tempted by Satan. We're going to see when he was tempted, how he was tempted, and exactly what he used to go through it. Because at this time when Jesus was tempted, he was the suffering servant. Watch what he uses, and we can do the same thing. Let's take a look at this. It's in Matthew chapter 4. It's a lengthy reading, but it's worth it. Matthew chapter 4, beginning at verse 1, it says, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, what do you think? Remember, he was in human flesh. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, what do you think the natural, normal feeling is? You're hungry. And it says, and he was hungry. And when the tempter being the devil, came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread. Now, what's going on here? Now, Jesus could have done this, but that wasn't his mission at the time. He was a suffering servant. He had to be all of mankind. So what did Satan do? And this is what Satan will do to us. He will come to us at what appears to be a low point in our life or a challenging point. Jesus was hungry. He was very much a man. He said, well, if you be the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. He was challenging his position of being God the Son and the fact that he was simply hungry. Put yourself in that position. You've been fasting 40 days and you like T-bone steaks off the grill like I do. And you're on day 39 and somebody flaming up a grill next door. Said, I just thought I'd bring this over to you and I'm supposed to be fasting. That's a hard, and it would have been easy to say, well, it's just this one time, but I committed to 40 days. Now I'm just using a simple story. I wouldn't fast for 40 days, but I'm just saying if that's what I committed to, because that's the hidden meaning behind when we read about Sapphira, why they, her and her husband were struck down. Why? Because they didn't keep their commitment that they made to God. People say, would God do that now? The emphasis is keep your commitment. But let's see, what did Jesus do? Did Jesus give up and say, well, it's just one thing? Watch what he does. Verse 4. But he, is Jesus, answered and said, It is written. It is written. Now, this is the Son of God, folks, who could do anything. He says, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Satan knew when to come to him, came to him the moment when he was hungry, appeared to be vulnerable, and he's challenging him because he's the Son of God. What did Christ do? He says, it is written. He went to God's word. Did you open up his Bible and show it to Satan? It was in his heart. What did David say? That word have I hidden in my heart that I may not sin against thee. He had it in his heart. And that's what he used on Satan. The Son of God used that on Satan. Notice what this is going back to 1 John 2 and 16. This is the lust of the flesh. The flesh was hungry. But Jesus let God's word reign supreme. We have the same ability. Let's continue on because it doesn't end. Verse 5, then, see, the devil doesn't stop. Then the devil taketh him up into a holy city and setteth him on the pinnacle of the temple and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, here we go again, cast thyself down. Now notice what Satan uses, for it is written. See how he tries to mimic Christ, but he's doing it in a way to try to bring you down. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands shall they bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. What do I want to say about this? You've all heard me say this. There was a movie came out years ago. It wasn't just this one. It was other ones that use scripture. That's all they do, though, because it's not in context. People say, have you seen the last one? Have you seen that movie Left Behind? Ooh, isn't that something? I was like, what's amazing about it? Well, you know, they use scripture. That is so false. Every scripture is out of context, folks. I couldn't put one scripture, and when I looked at it, I was like, every scripture is out of context. It's misleading, which leads to false doctrine, which leads to people thinking they're saved, but they're not, because they can't prove it through scripture and context. So look at old slippery Satan saying, for it is written. But you think that got to Jesus? And see, he took him up and showed him. It's like, well, you got all this power. Pride of life is what he's trying to get from him. You can dash your foot. You charge over the angels. What did Jesus do? Verse 7, Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Put it right back in context. See, not only do you have to know your scripture, you have to know how to use your scripture when somebody comes trying to throw scripture at you, but it's out of context. Verse 8, again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. Key word is show. He's appealing to the lust of the eyes. Like, look, you can have all this. Now I've heard people say, well, Satan didn't control all that. Well, you gotta use scripture. Jesus, when he was in a boat, said, the God of this world, he used small g. Satan runs all of this, but he's not in control. That's what we have to remember. Satan has influenced this whole world through his influence. But we're supposed to obey God. Verse 10, what did Jesus say? Then said Jesus unto him, get thee hence, Satan. You see those three words again? It is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, in whom only shalt thou serve. Look at verse 11. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. See, Satan had nowhere else to go. He had used the lust of the flesh. He had used the pride of life. He had used the lust of the eyes. He had nowhere else to go. But what did Jesus use every single time Satan came at him? He used scripture in context. I tell people, if you want motivation to want to learn more and more about the Bible, study. That's the motivation, because you can put Satan in check. Many people tell me, you know, I appreciate how you study so you can preach. No, that's not why I study. Preaching is just a byproduct of what I've learned. I study because I want to be able to do this in my life. I don't know if you all know, this life is hard. Things can be thrown at you just out of the blue, and people will want to check you to see how you're going to respond. And I want to respond like a Christian every time, even if it means taking a hit. Because I'm not taking a hit for myself. I'm taking a hit on the cause of Christ. But that has to be our perspective, church. It has to be. If we can't get past the perspective, the game is over. An example of me and my brother Gail use all the time, talking about sports. He coaches the basketball a lot. And he said many times when, you know, he coaches the younger kids, and they're not, a lot of them aren't very tall. Some of them are tall. And many times if his team comes out and they look at the other team and the team is real tall, they're looking like, oh, man. He told him, he's like, what's wrong? The game is over if you all feel that way. You can't go on the court, look at the other team. He's like, man, they're big and tall. Yeah, but they may not be able to play. And the coach may not be able to coach. But you have to keep your head in the game. It's no different for us. There is nothing. Many of us, we will sit here and we'll say, greater is he that is within us than he that is of the world. We believe that, right? Do we act like that when problems come into our lives? Or do we fall back to, why is this happening to me? You know, we're talking about reframing in Bible class this morning. One way we can reframe that is when we realize 1 Corinthians says, 1 Corinthians 10 lets us know that what's happening to us is common. As opposed to saying, why is this happening to me? We should say, God is saying, I can handle this. And something of it is going to come out to benefit somebody. I don't want to spend too long here, but many of you know, years ago, I had a very, very touch and go operation for brain surgery. And I remember I sat there and I cried a little bit. Not always me, it's just like, you just don't know what the outcome is going to be. I tried my best to prepare myself for heaven, but staying on this side of life is like a person asking you, if you had to die, which way do you want to go? You want to go in your sleep or you want to burn up? I think everybody would say go in their sleep. I wasn't sure what the complications would be afterwards. Praise God, there's none. But my whole point of saying that is we have to stay so locked into what we believe and accept God, whatever God delivers to us. As long as we're in God, we're good. That's what the story of the three Hebrew boys are all about. They were set to go no matter what, because they were in the hands of God. That has to be our perspective going into this. It'll make life is still going to be challenging. The Bible doesn't say anywhere life is going to be easy. All it says is not impossible. And he promised to be with us through it. People say, well, how do you get close to God? The more and more you know about his word, the closer you can become. Because you know how close he is to you. But maybe remember just how important this perspective is. Also with perspective, in Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 7, it says, let this mind, we know what mind is, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now watch this. Who being in the form of God, thought it not a robbery to be equal with God. Because Jesus was God the Son. But when he came down here, it says, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant. That's what he's doing in Matthew chapter 4. He took upon the form of a suffering servant. He was going to do it without using any special power and was made in the likeness of men. You want to read something powerful about it? Read Isaiah 53. It talks about it's the suffering servant. He did that for us. So how can we put on the mind of Christ? We can't just put his mind on us. When you pick up wonderful 66 books, you know what this is? We call it the Bible, and that's what it is. But this is really the mind of God. This gives us access to the mind of God and what we need to know. That's why I say maybe never take this for granted. You know, you can visit homes. They have the big, beautiful family Bibles. We have one. Don't let that be the only one in your house that you open up and put birth certificates in and everything. Nothing wrong with that. And may you pick it up and use it as the wonderful word of God that it's intended to be. It wasn't designed to be an ornament. It was just designed to be living word. God expects that of us. But may we remember that perspective. The next part, we go back to 1 Corinthians 10 and 13. After it mentions what is common to men, it says, but God, but implies there's a transition. So not only do you realize that whatever you're going through, God is saying you can handle it. I've seen some people deal with 3-4 things at once. I was like, God is telling you, you got broad shoulders, brother. You can handle it. Because he's saying you can go through it. And whatever God is saying you can go through, he's still in charge. We forget that part. God is still, that's what the book of Revelation is all about. God is still in charge no matter how bad it gets. It's just how much will you let that get to you? Or where will your focus be, on what God said or what Satan said? The reason why we live in a fallen world is because God told Adam what he was supposed to do. Satan came along, told Eve something else, and they did what Satan said. Added one word, you all know what it is, not. Thus we live in a fallen world until Christ comes back again. So may we remember to have the proper perspective. What about the power? It says, but God is faithful. But God is faithful. And that's a simple phrase, but that's saying he will never let you down. The issue is with us. That's why many times you won't ever find the word contract in the Bible, not even in Hebrew or Greek. All the agreements are considered covenants. You know why? Because that's God putting trust in you're going to do what you're going to do. He is going to do what he's already done, and that's provide for us. A covenant is not based on any written agreement. It's based upon, and it's based upon verbal agreement. You're going to, like the old, the bartering system they shook on it. God's given us his word. If we accept it, we're supposed to do what it says. What's amazing about that for those that say, well, life is hard. I'm going to sin. I'm going to make mistakes. You know what he's provided for Christians? As we said this morning in Bible class, his blood still flows. So like a mentor preacher of mine said, what do you have to complain about? A lot of people can't handle that kind of verbiage, but he's right. We are supposed to sin less, but when we do sin, his blood still flows. So we always have an opportunity. That's what perfect in Christ actually means. It doesn't mean you won't make any mistakes or you won't fall. It means that when you do, you should have the mindset to get back up and do all you can for Christ. And as a person once asked me, why would God set it up that way? Because he's setting it up so it gives you a more stronger perspective, and it allows you to tie back into his power. That's how powerful it is. His power is showing up where you can mess up and still get the same status right back if your heart is in the right place. Let's look at this, but God is faithful. What that faithfulness ties into is just how powerful God is and what he's done for us. Through his power, he's given us a lot of benefits. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, for God hath not given us a spirit of fear. But what has he given us? He's given us but a power, there's that word, and of love and of a sound mind. The power, we're going to talk about this a little bit later. The power is what we're birthed out of. We're going to see that in the gospel of Christ. The love is, it's literally unconditional. If we do wrong, he doesn't like our ways, but he still loves the soul. And he's provided for the soul. That's why we're supposed to invest in our soul. That's the whole part of this lesson. And it says, end of a sound mind. You know what that sound mind refers to? We should be able, we're geared up as Christians. We're geared up, we're designed to make it through anything if we let our mind be like Christ. That's what that sound mind comes from. No matter what you may face tomorrow, you are prepared. God prepared you to make it through it. It's just, do you use the tools? Let's look at Romans 8:39. What else has God given us? It says, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. What I love about this verse, it gives us the method where God provides this assurance. It's only through Christ Jesus. You can't find it outside of Christ Jesus. How do you get into Christ Jesus? We're going to end the lesson with that. And you have to know, don't let Satan tell you that there's another way. People ask Christ into my heart, all these different things. You got to make sure, because when we say saved, that means you're saved from your sins. You can only be saved from your sins by coming in contact with the blood of Christ, which leads to the question, when did you come in contact with the blood? You don't do that through prayer and asking. There's a specific act that you must do that allows you to come into the contact of the blood of Christ. But nothing can separate us from the blood. That's power. And in 1 Peter 5:7, This is the one where many of us still struggle and we have to be careful. It says, casting all your care, that's anxiety is what care means, upon him, him being Jesus, for he careth for you. One of the things I love about doing word studies, that word casting, it literally touches almost every possible definition we have in the English for casting. The first one is talking about, we have any fishermen in here? You ever cast a net out or cast a line out to catch a fish? It implies that you have to do something first. You can't just have a fishing pole and say, hey, Tyrone, I'm going fishing. Okay, go ahead. I ain't got no line on. You probably think I'm crazy sitting here waiting all day to catch something. Ain't got no line. I got to do some preparation. The preparation here is simply giving it over to Jesus. That sounds so simple, doesn't it? How many times have you struggled with something and then realized, I haven't even prayed about this yet? Or used every possible strategy to get out of a problem, but then just literally give it to Jesus and pray about it. The other casting comes from the theatrical world. And that is when you make a movie, you typically don't have one person playing all the roles. You get a cast to help support. They call it a supporting cast. It's the same way in Christianity. When we go through things, we need a supporting cast. The Bible says, confess ye your faults to one another. I tell you, it makes it much easier because then you realize, I told you about when I went through my surgery. I had a chance. I didn't know why I went through that, but I was able to share that experience with somebody that really blessed their life. I never will forget that day because I sat down and said, Lord, now I understand. I had made it out, was fully through it, no hardcore residual effects, and was able to share the experience. And that's very similar to what this lady's son went through. Was it worth it? Absolutely. And we have to look at it that way. But casting all our care upon him. Can we do that? As simple as that sounds, that's a part of the power that we have. We just have to give it up. It's so easy to sit down and it keeps coming. People keep saying, well, every time I sit down and think about it, it comes to my mind. What did Paul tell us in Philippians? When that happens, pray. You see, we have a tool for everything. It's just harder to use them when we don't use them. Now, I can't think of a time when I've ever had to use a chainsaw, Brother Gil. Matter of fact, when we used them in the Marine Corps, we had to use the handsaws. So somebody at Melbourne threw me a handsaw and said, Brother, let's go ahead and chop down that tree. I said, probably take a look at the instructions because all I see is fast turning blades. And that could take off a foot, a hand, or a head. So I would have to go and look at it. Such is the case when we don't use these things. God has given us these tools to use daily. The biggest part of power that I want us to realize as we advance on is in Romans 1:16, and we should know this verse. Romans 1:16, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. In other words, it's designed for everybody. This, if you're a Christian, you were birthed out of the gospel of Christ. And that's where we're supposed to pull our power source from. When you read in Revelation, the Church of Philadelphia, it talks about their first love. Their first love was the gospel. It's amazing what God and his people can do when we have God. You see three letters on the board, on the screen. It says TNT. You know what's amazing about TNT? I'm going to read this one slowly. TNT is a yellow odorless solid that does not occur naturally in the environment. Is Christian behavior a natural thing? No, it's supernatural. We need God's help to do this. That's why we have his word. It says it is made by combining toluene with a mixture of nitric and sulfuric acids. It is a highly explosive single ring norioaromic compound that is a crystalline solid at room temperature. What's amazing about that, those two ingredients that make TNT, if you have them apart, they're docile. There's nothing explosive about either one of them when they're apart. But you mix those two chemicals, you have a powerful explosive. You know what happens when we mix with the gospel of Christ? We tie into the power of God, and he gives us salvation. You know how we're supposed to live? I apologize for not putting the scripture on the screen, but the Bible lets us know that we become more than conquerors. Now, during Bible times, when you said conqueror, that meant something. That meaning you overtook something that was absolutely amazing, just conqueror. The Bible says we're more than conquerors. What could that possibly mean? That means although Christ does not come back, heaven is not here yet, we're supposed to live like we've already overcome everything. That's what makes it possible. In other words, you've heard people say, bring it on. That's a spiritual way of saying, bring it on. Because I know Christ has got my back. I got my vest on. The impact may hurt. It may knock you down, but it's supposed to keep you down. No, you're supposed to get back up. And better yet, you should have friends, that fellowship that can get you back up. That's why I'm so grateful for this wonderful YAMS group we have going on. They stick together. That's a beautiful thing. That's going to bless you guys a lot in life, the young adults in ministry and service. But maybe remember, we should always tie back into the power. We often tie into the circumstance. It's like, well, I'm not trying to make light of this, but this is what a circumstance can do to us. And one lady was terrified. I can't cross this part of 441. And I said, why not? Well, a couple of years ago when I crossed with a car, now 441 is rough. I don't know if you know 441. Traffic is horrible. But she crossed and didn't see a car, and the car hit her. And it broke one of her legs, and she was out of commission from walking for almost 3 years. So because of that one incident, no matter what, she'll go all the way around to avoid that. Now, if she chooses that, that's her own free will. But I'm saying, look how a circumstance changed a lady's complete way of thinking. I'm just saying that we have in us ways to even overcome that. We shouldn't let anything make us think that we can't do it. Not one thing, because we are possible. The Bible lets us know some of the simplest verses in the Bible. Through Christ, all things. That's what it says. It's an absolute verse. Through Christ, all things are possible. The question is, do we believe that? And the second thing, are we willing to act on it? Or are we afraid to get hurt? Remember the vest, it's going to hurt, but it's going to make you better. When I was in the Marine Corps, a part of the process of being certified, they would use CS gas because Saddam Hussein was gassing people in Iraq. We went over there. They sent us through it. Of course, when they said that, I thought they were joking. They weren't joking. We had to be exposed to it with nothing on. And then within 7 seconds, we had to don and clear a gas mask. And then come out, and it's like, wow. They wanted you to know what it was like. God has equipped us to make it through this world. Are we using the tools? The perspective, the power. Now the providence. Back to 1 Corinthians 10 and 13. Notice what this says. I mean, this is powerful, folks. It says, who will not suffer you. That's saying God will not suffer you to be tempted above what ye are able. God won't allow that. That's why I kept saying, no matter what you're going through, it may be bad. It may feel horrible and it may be tragic. God is still in control. We miss that part. That's why I go over this scripture at least once every day. Because there's a little piece that'll jump out more and more each time. We understand we won't go through more than what other people can go through. It's common. But God is still in control. Let's see a great example. Luke 8, 43 and 44. Another one of my favorites. It says, in a woman having an issue of blood 12 years. Now, I won't go into all the detail what the issue of blood is, but the ladies know that's not a good thing. And she had it 12 years. Now, I've yet to hear of another lady deal with this 12 years. What do you think the natural mentality would be? It would be so easy to say when people came by, hey, let's go. No, I don't want to go out. I ain't feeling too good. Or can we do this? No. That's enough just to pull you down. Watch what you did. Which had spent all her living on physicians. Now, it didn't say she spent $50,000. It says she spent all her living on physicians. So at least she had to drive to try to seek out an opportunity to get it cured, but it didn't come from physicians. Would that be enough for us to say, well, I guess I want just to submit myself to a dull life being down? It would have been so easy to do that. Neither could be healed of any. They even had those witch doctors back then. The Bible doesn't say she went to any, but it says nobody could heal her. What do you think the mentality would be? Give up? Watch this. Came behind him. Him was Jesus. You see, she kept going, and touched the border of his garment. Notice what the next two words say. And immediately, wasn't the next day, and immediately her issue of blood stanched, which means it stopped and was cured. When you get a chance and when you read Luke 8, you realize it was an extension of her faith and who she came in contact with. A lot of good people in this world have faith, but they haven't come in contact with Jesus' doctrine. And that's the tragedy. When I meet good people, good moral people, like when you read about Cornelius in the Bible, Cornelius eventually became saved, but when he was doing a lot of good stuff, he still wasn't saved. He couldn't work his way to heaven. He still had to come into the contact with the gospel of Christ. But for us who are on the other side of the sacrifice, who know the doctrine of Christ, are we giving up too soon? Are we still seeking? This lady was relentless. 12 years is a long time. What is the mentality like? I have one more for you that's similar. Another one of my favorites. In 2 Kings 5 and 2, it says, and the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel, a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. What's going on here? The nation of Israel had been overrun by the Syrians, and they would always take captives. They took this little maiden. Her name is not given in scripture, but they took this little Israel maiden and put her in one of the head captain's house, and she served the enemy. What do you think her mentality was like? Ripped up out of her family in a foreign land, a servant for the enemy. You think she would be real joyous? You know, she never forgot about who she really was. That's why I'm glad her name is not mentioned in the Bible. The focus is on her mentality and what she did and who she was. Watch this. By the way, her husband Naaman had leprosy. That's like one of the worst diseases you could have in biblical times. Watch what this young lady, as opposed to being angry and upset, watch what this young lady does in verse 3. And she said unto her mistress, that's Naaman's wife, the lady she was serving, would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy. She's telling, it's old English, for she's telling her master that, well, your husband has leprosy. I know a prophet in the land of Samaria, talking about Elijah. If he goes there, he can be cured of his leprosy. They came and took her captives, but she's looking to help them. You see what that is? Folks, this is all the providence of God. She knows that God is going to take care of her no matter what. The lady with the 12 issues of blood knew God would take care of her. That's why they kept the faith, no matter what their circumstances were. The question is, what will we do? Are we as Christians going to tie into the providence of God? Or are we going to let the situation just tear us apart? Next to the last one, now we go to the plan. 1 Corinthians 10 and 13, the bolded part, it says, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape. This scripture is so powerful, it almost doesn't need any preaching. But will with the temptation also make a way to escape. This is what God has told Christians, folks. He said, no matter what you're going through, he has provided a way to escape. Some of us saying, well, why can't it happen right up front? That mentality is a part of the problem. It's just there may be things we have to learn. It may be a consequence, or we may be the issue. Let's look at some scripture on that. It says, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape? That's already preset. Colossians 1, 10 and 11. There are three areas that can help us to have the right mentality, so the process should not take as long as we can make it. It says in verse 10, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord, unto all pleasing. How do we get there? Being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Verse 11 is the kicker. Strengthened with all might. How is that? According to his glorious power, there's the power again, unto all patience, long-suffering, and joyfulness. Apply this to a given situation. Let's look at each one. Patience. We spoke about that this morning. Patience, you've heard the phrase patience is a virtue. It is. There's so many things that could have been accomplished in life, in all walks of life, just with a little bit of patience. Patience is mentioned all through the Bible. My favorite one, as I said in Bible classes, in the book of James, where it says, let patience have her perfect work. Notice that first word, let. That implies there's got to be a conscious effort on your part. It's not just going to happen. Like Brother Gill says all the time, you're looking for a job? People asking, you need a job? Yes. Well, what are you doing? I'm sitting back hoping. Hope is not a strategy. You're not putting out resumes. You're not going on the line. Then you can still pray and have hope, but you're putting in some work as well. That's where the patience comes in place. It's so easy to jump when we lack patience. Now connect patience with long suffering. Many people will try to give the definition of long suffering the meaning patience. They're two very distinct. They're close, they're like belief and faith, but they're mutually exclusive. Patience is the wherewithal, meaning no matter what you're going through, it's the way of your life. The long suffering is when you meet that problem. How quick are you to prejudge? How quick are you just to get out of it? The long suffering comes from a direct tie-in with using God's word. People, are you still dealing with him? They don't know nothing about your business. Let the long suffering be used first. If you want the best definition, go to 1 Corinthians 13 and read the definition of what love is all about. You'll see long suffering, you'll see kind, you'll see patience, you'll see enduring. The best synonym for long suffering is endurance. You know where that word comes from? It comes from racing in a marathon. And when you start off, anybody starting off a marathon is gonna feel decent, right? Because you haven't run it all. You're just like, okay. And then you get around mile 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, anywhere in between there, you're gonna start catching some heavy breathing. Those that have been trained to run know how to endure that and know, okay, I got a few more to go. Let me catch my breath. That's a perfect analogy for life as a Christian as you deal with things in life. Can you endure it? And the only way to endure it is using scripture. It even said Christ endured the cross. Guess how Christ endured the cross? This is one that blows my mind. It says he endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. You all heard me use that scripture. In other words, the motivation for Christ to continue on with his walk to the cross was knowing that he would save us. And we were yet while in our sins. That's some serious love, folks. What do you need to endure? I try to work hard. I think about Stephanie and my two boys. Or I should say my young men now, not the young boys anymore. That's a form of endurance. You build up strategies for endurance, but the best ones are Bible-based. And the last one, after long suffering, joyfulness. You know what's powerful about joyfulness? And Gail does a great job breaking this down. Joy and happiness aren't mutual, they aren't interchangeable. There's nothing wrong with being happy, but happy is designed to be circumstantial. If I walk out Brother Hart and crash my car, I wrap service, I'm not going to be yippee. But then a Brother Lindsay comes by and says, don't worry about it, brother. I got a new BMW for you. Yippee, yeah. Then it's good. There's nothing wrong with those emotions. They fit the circumstances. And we are emotional people. But joy is having that resilience, that you're content no matter what happens. See, if I destroy my car, yeah, I may not be happy, but I still have joy. I walked away. I'm fine. My boys and my young men are fine. And I'm going to live another. I live to work another day and buy another car. Joy is supposed to pull you through all of that. There is no joy greater than knowing that you're saved in Christ Jesus. The key part is knowing that you're saved. And knowing means you got to prove it through scripture. And the scripture has to be in context. That's where the religious world has lost their minds with. They'll just believe anything now. And as we hasten on to an end, the last part is the pathway. The pathway. Notice what the last part says. That whole verse 13 is so amazing. That ye may be able to bear it. In other words, the path has been cleared for you even before you hit these incredible tribulations. God has got your back. We have to believe that, though. My wife and I watches a show that we love on Netflix called Heartland. And this young boy and girl had went to this big farm, and the farm is a maze. You know, if you know corn can grow real tall. They had made a maze out of the corn, and they had a map there that you could take in case you get lost. Okay, they didn't take the map. They went in there, and then before you know it, Sister Valerie, sun went down. I don't know about you all, but a corn field is not a place to be when it's dark. It looks scary. And of course, they got terrified. Then the girl said, "We didn't grab a map." And he said, "No." It's like, oh my goodness. They had a clear pathway that they could have taken, but they chose not to take it. They eventually made it out by pure love. But God has given us a pathway. And if we don't recognize it now before we get into it, we can be lost. It says that ye may be able to bear it. Let's see what scripture tells us in 1 Corinthians 13:7. It says, beareth all things. Now, this is talking about what love brings. Beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Why is this so important? This is supposed to be how we're supposed to deal with each other. And a person may say, well, I can't believe everything. You got to keep it in context. Let's just say if somebody said, man, did you hear Brother Lindsay's a thief? He robbed a bank. And I just heard that for the first time. I've been knowing Brother Lindsay for a number of years. Why should I be so quick to want to believe that? But if we aren't careful, you know what we'll do? Hey, Sister Faye, how you doing? Did you hear about Lindsay? And that's where it starts. Well, how's he doing? They say he robbed a bank. You see, I'm not believing all things. I'm not helping this situation at all. It's so important for us as Christians. When we go the other way, as we said in Bible class, all we're doing is helping save. We are only perfect through Christ Jesus. May we remember that that pathway has been made for us. And the pathway, what I love about the pathway leads right back to the first P, which was perspective. You have to tell yourself when you're going through something, God has made a way out for this for me. You got to say that and you got to believe it. And then you got to act on faith. This is what the Bible says, folks. And it's crystal clear on it. I hope, trust, and pray that we can use this. Now, to even use these five P's, you have to get into Christ. The world may tell you a lot of stuff. Let me tell you what the Bible says. In Acts 15:7, it says you have to hear and believe the gospel. And you may think, what is the gospel? Go to Romans 1:16. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Now you may think, okay, I remember you reading that earlier, but what is the gospel? We even go further, go to Galatians 1:6-9. The Bible lets us know that there's only one gospel or one doctrine to be saved. And you're going to be amazed. It has nothing to do with asking Christ into your heart. It has nothing to do with touching your hand to the screen or anything. The Bible makes it clear what the gospel is. Some people try to be cute and say, well, you know what? The gospel is the whole Bible. They think that's a safe answer, but that's not what the Bible says. The gospel is contained within the Bible. Because gospel simply means the good news or the best information about a given topic. Bible has a lot of good news, but there's one best information. And it's found in the next scripture, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 through 4. Paul even lets you know, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, wherein ye stand. And it even says, wherein ye are saved. How can you get around that? You can't unless you're promoting false doctrine. But it lets us know that the gospel of Christ is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel. We're going down to Acts 15 and 7, and lets us know that we must repent. And that repentance is turning from turning from our ways to God's way. And it's easy for a new person to say, well, I can't, that's a lot of books. I can't learn all that. You're not expected to be baptized. You're just expected to know exactly what I'm talking about, what's on the screen now. That qualifies you to be baptized if you accept that. Then from there, we have new convert classes, sermons, and Bible class to help you grow. And fellowship, most importantly. In Acts 8, 37, we're supposed to make a confession. We're supposed to simply confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, because that's the basis of all the doctrine that we teach that's found in the Bible. And the last one, Acts 8 and 38, you're going to be baptized. That's what's behind the screen. You're going to be baptized because you're going to obey a gospel of death, burial, and resurrection by being baptized. You're not sprinkled. We're not baptizing babies. We baptize people that understand. When you go down in that water, what's amazing, according to Acts 2 and 38, God gives you the Holy Spirit. In other words, he dwells in you. That's powerful. Acts 22 and 16, he washes away all your sins through his blood. That's how you come in contact with the blood of Christ. You can't pray that into your heart or say the sinner's prayer. That doesn't tie up to coming in contact with the blood of Christ. You see, when you go down, you're obeying the death, burial, and resurrection. You tie into his death, because in his death, when you read in the Gospels, that's where he shed his blood. And without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. Your sins go back to the cross, and his blood can cover it. If you don't do that, you're a guilty distance away from Christ. And then the big one, Acts 2 and 47, he adds you to the church, to the church. Not just any church that's preaching anything and teaching anything, but to the church of Christ. Then when you come up out of the water, Revelation 2 and 10, you're supposed to be faithful unto the death. That simply means you're supposed to be faithful in your life. Christ died for us. We're supposed to live for him. If while Brother Lindsay sings a song of invitation, if anybody wants to obey the gospel, then simply come forward. We will gladly help you out with that and ask you a few more questions. If you're a Christian who's just been struggling and you've been falling down but not getting up, the Bible says the prayers of the righteous avails much. Submit your prayer requests. If you're listening on Zoom, start putting them in the Zoom requests now. If you have the cards, please fill them out. Brothers will come down the aisle. If you're visiting, please fill out a card too. The brothers will get the cards as well. If you see the need to respond, please do so now as we all together stand and sing the song of encouragement.